Yep. We are blessed in this city to have one of the greatest Christian blues players in the city, in the world. Come on. So welcome our brother, Jimmy and Sherry Bratcher. Sherry's back there. Give us a wave, Sherry. Welcome Jimmy as he comes and ministers to us this morning.
Good morning. I got all dressed up for church this morning. Those of you that aren't from Kansas City don't understand. But Sherry and I are thankful to be here. We're always grateful for Dennis and Denise and everybody that's here and this church and all that it represents around the world. And I was thinking I was tossed up between two songs to play today. I couldn't figure out whether to play Whole Lot of Shaking Going On or the one I'm going to play. So this song that I'm going to play is a song, and I'm not trying to make a political statement, but you'll take it that way. This song's about wearing masks. But not the kind that have been imposed on us, but the kind that we impose or feel that we have to wear to protect ourselves from each other. You know, it's one of the, and this is a sad commentary, but I'm going to say it anyway, one of the least safest places in the world is in church. And it's because we feel that we're not safe with each other, and therefore we have to mask ourselves with all manner of pretense in order to protect ourselves from being hurt. And at some point, I believe that we'll be able to really take off those masks and really, you know, the Bible says that we will be known, we will see him, you know, him fully, but we will also be known as we are known. We'll be able to lay aside those facades that we put on to try to protect ourselves from each other and be safe for each other. And I don't know about you, but I call that being real. It's like, you know, I got all these scars and everything, and I always go back to the movie Replacements, Clint, chicks dig scars. And that wasn't a spiritual confessionary either, by the way, but that was a joke. But anyway, this song talks about, it's really about hypocrites. Because a hypocrite in the Bible is a cultural reference to a Greek theater actor who would put on an entire performance by simply changing masks. And so my heart is that we would be able to take off those masks, see each other as we really are, and still continue to love each other. It's called Beautiful People.
Beautiful people, I wanna see them everywhere.
about is happy. That's the way it seems. Nobody listens to her silent screams. Only for a moment to see beyond the veil. Face the truth that our beauty has failed. I wanna look at beautiful people. I wanna see.
At us. They've got a lot of great products from music to rib rubs. Come on back there, cookbooks.
Is that song on the new one? No. Because it's not a food, it's not a food song. That was beautiful. So I just wanted to stand up here with Dennis to introduce our speakers today and just say we've known about them for a long time. Then we had a divine encounter out at Andrews, where we got to spend a little time, and you are blessed today. We're privileged today to have them here. What a gift to the body of Christ, and great resources they brought. And I bought their new book, and but we're just honored and privileged that they're here. They're pastors from Georgia. I don't know the exact city. It's out
just south of Atlanta.
Just south of Atlanta. So you might even know some people, friends that live there. You could send them to their church. But I just want to say, divine connection. We love and appreciate you and glad you're here.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, from Forward Church in Atlanta, Georgia, will you welcome Clint and Sarah Byers? Come on.
Thank you.
Thank you guys.
Well, like they said, we've known about your church and always have heard great things. You know, I worked for Jim Richards back in the early 2000s. We moved to Huntsville to go to Bible college with the purpose of getting trained at Impact to go back to Atlanta to start a church, which we did. We started Forward Church a little bit over a decade ago. And we met you guys, I don't know if y'all remember that, but we were there when Jim first moved into, we first moved into the University Drive building, you know, the big hotel building. I remember meeting you guys then. And so it's been a while, but you know, now that our paths merge, I'm excited to see what God's doing. So, and you know, y'all know this, but you have great pastors. And they're so welcoming and embracing, and you know, we're excited to be just embraced into this community, to get to know Nate and the rest of the conference speakers, and Kelvin and Abby. Of course, Abby we've known online for quite a while. Who else am I missing? Who else is part of the
Hans?
Hans is just one of those. You're like glue in the body of Christ. You just hold people together. And Hans will text and pursue and maintain the relationship. You know, just for a long time, I wasn't all that big on external relationships because I'm a pastor. I'm a local church guy. And I love day after day, the week after week, time with our people. But God seems to be using us lately, now that our kids are a little bit older, which I don't have a picture of them. Our kids are 17 and 19, Reese and Sydney, and they're at home, and I don't think there's any raging parties happening, and I think the house will still be standing when we get home, and they're very trustworthy, so we're excited. So, Sarah, you have...
Opposite of us. We did everything.
Yeah, no, they can't get anything past us because we have all the stories. We weren't really raised in church, but that's a whole other story.
So I don't normally come up here and share. And, of course, Clint was like, you know, you can come up here if you have something. And I didn't think I had anything until the last song of worship. And I just felt like I needed to come up here and share it. I don't want to take up too much time, so I did quick condensed version. But I know what stood out for me from that song was, it's your breath in our lungs. So let's think about that for a minute. When we believe, say, when I believe, Jesus is in me.
Jesus is in me.
So he literally takes place in our bodies. He's never going to leave. And think about the power that's in Jesus, the cross, the blood, the miracles. He's in our lungs. So when we're taking a breath, or when we're praying for somebody, where are we praying from? Are we praying from out there or about the power that's in us?
Yeah.
And we're not praying for the world to come into place. We are his hands and feet. We are the ones who are going to bring the prayers, the miracles, the positive words.
That's right.
And so we just need to remember, with every breath that we're breathing, we have the power of God.
Amen. Amen. Good work. You can give that to them. Good job. That she doesn't know it, but she's prophesying what I'm speaking about. You know, this. Oh, by the way, when we were packing and getting ready to take this trip, I felt like the Lord said, pack your Star Spangled Banner socks, which I have these Star Spangled Banner socks. You see them? And I don't normally bring these. I just usually wear basic black socks. But I felt, pack your Star Spangled Banner socks. I'm like, okay. And so then I'm putting my shoes on this morning, and I reach for my typical black socks, and I felt him say, nope, grab the stars and stripes. I'm like, all right. Yeah. And then you said, Dennis, we are standing for our nation.
Yes.
And I just felt like that was just kind of a prophetic expression of us standing for our nation. Kelvin, I appreciate you bringing the prayer and that word. Because, you know, unity, they are trying very hard to divide us, aren't they?
Yep. Yeah.
But we are uniters in the kingdom. Say, I am a kingdom uniter. And the word that Sarah brought is about us being a blessing. Say, I am a blessing to the nations, one life at a time. You know, sometimes it feels like it's too big of a task for us to be a blessing to the nations, right? For us to disciple the nations. But it's one life at a time. It starts in the mirror. It starts in our families, our immediate surroundings, and then beyond, however God will use you in that setting, right? Yeah. And so that's what I want to talk about. I have a pretty simple message. We've gone pretty deep in this conference. How many of you have been part of the conference? Yeah, I think most people here. If you haven't been part of those sessions, they're cataloged on the L3 International Facebook page, right? Is Nathan here? Oh, there you are. They're still up, right? On your L3 International YouTube channel, that you'll put those over there. I would encourage going back and watching those. So, you know, in a conference like that, it's about the heart of the gospel. You take the time to kind of go deep. And you know, a lot of us are walking out the journey, you know, that Jim Richards has deposited in this place, and Andrew and Dave. And you know, so when we were back in Huntsville working for Jim, and Jim would always come out here, and he'd always come home with these crazy stories of this guy, Dave Duell, you know, and I've just heard so much about him. Sarah and I met him one time, and that was in Oklahoma, and he wasn't even ministering, and we just happened to be at the same conference together. So, you know, I'm regretful that we didn't get to meet him, But I know that you guys carry on that legacy and that discipleship, so I look forward to meeting him in heaven and watching him do his thing there. You know, so. But I want to talk about just this idea of being a blessing, you know, because from the beginning of time, God has desired to walk among his people. And as he walks among his people, he has desired to be a blessing to his people. You can, yeah, good job. He's following me along there. Sometimes you go and you're like, you think the guy in the back is asleep. You want to go knock on him, but yeah. But that's what God has desired from the beginning, is to walk among us and just be a blessing to us and then equip us to be a blessing. So in this conference, we've gone pretty deep, but today what I want to do is mobilize you. In other words, I want you to take some steps. I want you to act. I don't want you to spend your Christianity just spending time working on yourself, trying to get the stuff working for you. Because a lot of times if you feel stuck, and how many of you ever felt stuck in your Christianity? If you're feeling stuck, one of the greatest things to do is move. Yes. One of the greatest things to do is get out of your own bubble and go minister to somebody. Even if it's just you go shake their hand and smile and give them a kind word when you're at a restaurant or whatever, you know what I mean? And then you just trust God for other opportunities. We all hear amazing testimonies and stories, and sometimes we think that our small interactions that we have the opportunities to have with people, it's insignificant and it doesn't really mean much. But every opportunity you have to be a blessing, take it. Yes. Amen? Because that's how we will turn the minds and the hearts of the people. Yes. Is displaying the kindness and the mercy of God, yes, the love of God. They'll know that we follow Jesus by our love for one another. And then John 17, Jesus prays that we are to unite in our love for one another, turn that love toward the world, and then they will believe that Jesus, that God sent Jesus for them too. It's all about love. It's all about the gospel. I did kind of a deeper dive into the 1700s awakening, and I read a book from Eric Metaxas. It was called If You Can Keep It, which is a quote of the line from Benjamin Franklin about our Constitution. And he framed this idea that the nation was ready to receive a constitution and a governmental structure based on self-governance, protecting our natural God-given rights, because people like Whitfield and Edwards and the Wesleys had traveled preaching the gospel throughout the colonies at that time. It was said that about 90% of the people in this nation would have heard George Whitfield preach. And they didn't have the internet. They didn't have television, right? He just traveled that much and spoke that much. But I like the way Metaxas put it together, in that the preaching of the gospel prepared the hearts and the mind of the people to govern themselves, to protect their God-given rights. And if we could somehow still continue to affect the nation with the gospel, it will prepare the hearts and the minds of the people to depend on God, not the government. Amen? Amen? It's about the gospel. And I'm telling you, I know y'all know the gospel. I just pray that you're taking the opportunities to spread it and teach it. And just, even in the little tidbits, just say, I am a blessing to the nations, one person at a time. Amen? So let me just kind of click through here, do a little bit of teaching. Y'all like teaching?
Yes.
Let's look at 2 Corinthians 6:16, the second part. This is where we are. This is who we are. So what I want you to do is walk out of here today with a picture of what is my place in the body of Christ. And if you don't know specifically what that is, that's okay. You are collectively part of a greater mission, and that is the entire body of Christ on this planet to be a blessing. And that I'll dig into that a little bit more. So 2 Corinthians 6:16, part B. For we are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell with them and walk among them, and I will be their God, and they will be my people. Just think about that for just a moment. God walking among his people. It's what he's desired from the very beginning. He would come into the garden in the cool of the day and walk with his people. We put the barriers there because we hardened our hearts and introduced sin and death, and he had to protect us from his presence, but he's always desired to walk among us so that he could bless us, so that we would be a blessing. I don't have any great and wonderful revelation today. That's the point. But I want to show you how serious God is about it. Walking with you so that you would be a blessing. Amen? I'll say it about 20 more times so you don't forget it later. So we see that God called Abram out of idol worship to bless him and bless the world through him. Genesis 12:2. This is God talking to Abram. I will make you into a great nation and I will bless you. Say, bless you. I will make you a great name and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on the earth will be blessed through you. Now, we know that Jesus took the curse. Amen. Praise God. But the mandate is still there, is that through Abraham, God would bless the nations of the earth. But first, bless him. So, blessing, and I don't have this in your version of the notes, but the definition of blessing in this context is prosperity and treaty of peace. That's what we are to bring to the nations, is prosperity and a treaty of peace. We are to go into the world and tell people, God is no longer holding your sin against you. Amen. Be reconciled to God. Open your heart to God through Christ and experience the wholeness of relationship that you have with God now. God has extended a treaty of peace toward the world. Peace toward the world God extends. And we get to be the people that introduce who God really is, the true character and nature of God, so that they will desire him and not turn away from it. Because religion is really good at pointing a finger at people's faces. And we don't want to do that. We want to be a blessing. We want to extend a hand of blessing. So in other words, to be a blessing, God wanted to bless Abraham so that Abraham would be a blessing. Ultimately, I'm going to show you how that's your responsibility now, is to be a blessing. You are to extend that treaty of peace that God extends to people. It's not up to you to tell people what they're doing wrong. They already know. I mean, you know, I speak the truth in love. I'm not saying don't confront sin. If it's appropriate, do it. It needs to happen. But from a place of wholeness and restoration, like we see with Jesus with the woman caught in adultery, right? Yes. I don't condemn you. Where are your condemners? Neither do I condemn you. Now go and sin no more. And it changed her life, that extension of peace. He extended that treaty of peace. And then we go down into Exodus 19, and we see with Moses, Exodus 19:5. Now then, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, then you shall be my own possession among all the peoples, for all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the sons of Israel. Keep that in mind, a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. And this is not talking about a geographic nation. It's talking about the people of God. Say, I am the people of God.
I am the people of God.
Amen? But that's what we are. More than anything, we are a, you can go back to the previous one. But more than anything, what we are, we carry the presence of God in this earth as a kingdom of priests.
Yes.
And what do priests do? They minister to the people.
Yes.
We know Jesus is our high priest, forever making intercession on our behalf. He's not interceding, asking God to forgive you like the old covenant priests did. You know, they would bring, you'd bring your sacrifice to the priest, and those priests would enact the sacrifice so that temporary forgiveness could be extended to you. Jesus is not in heaven operating as your high priest trying to get God to forgive you. He stands there as a testimony that you are forgiven.
Yes.
He stands there pointing back to his own blood, saying that blood, my blood that Jesus himself carried up into that heavenly holy of holies, that Jesus sprinkled on that mercy seat in that heavenly holy of holies, that blood is there right now as a testimony of your righteousness. If you ever wonder you're standing before the Father, remember the blood of Jesus is before the Father on that mercy seat as a testimony of your righteousness, because that's what Jesus paid for. And out of that, you go toward the world carrying this spiritual treaty of peace that we have in that blood to be a blessing. And so I want you to start thinking about, okay, practically, how can I be a blessing? Who can I be a blessing to? And how can, you know, practically, how can I bless them? So, a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. And so, who are the sons of Israel? Say, I am. And I'll just show you. Galatians 3:6. Just as Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness, therefore recognize that it is those who are of faith who are the sons of Abraham. Say, I'm a son of Abraham. the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel beforehand to Abraham, saying, all the nations will be blessed in you. So then, those who are of faith are blessed with Abraham the believer. I like that, Abraham the believer. Just insert your name. I am your name, the believer. Let's say that together. I am Clint the believer. One more time. I am Clint the believer. And you put your name in there. Your name's not Clint. Which, by the way, I'm from Atlanta. You know, we have the Falcons. It's hard to stay a believer. Let me just tell you. You guys have my homie. I like watching that guy play. He's awesome. I can lay down the black and red and pull for my homie when I'm watching him play. It's all right. Isn't that what you call him?
I like
that. My homie? Mahomes? That's his nickname, right? My homie? That's what I've heard him called.
It works.
So, God desired to walk among his people, continued with Moses. We see that, right? We see that God brought the nation of Israel out, and he wanted them to build a temple so that he could dwell among them. That's what he told Moses. Go get my people so that I can dwell among them. God has always wanted to be with his people. He's not looking for a reason to distance himself from us. When you miss it, he's not running from you. He's not hiding from you. He's not looking for a reason to distance himself from you. Exodus 25:8, we see, have them construct a sanctuary for me so that I may dwell among them. Say, dwell among them. According to all that I'm going to show you, as the pattern of the tabernacle and as the pattern and all its furniture, so you shall construct it. Why? So that he could dwell among them. And then eventually we see God dwelt in the temple. That was the dedication of the temple. And I'm going to skip those verses there and go down to the 14th one. God finally was let out of the box through Christ. God got out the box.
That's good.
I know Jimmy's got a song, Get Out the Boat. God said, I'm going to get out the box. I don't want to just walk outside of them. I don't want to just walk among them. I want to be in them. Amen? All right. Ooh, I'm getting a preacher here. I'm banging your table. So then we see in Jesus what happened. So what I'm just walking you through is just kind of this idea of what God has wanted from the beginning of time. He's wanted to be with his people. He's wanted to walk among us. He's wanted to bless us so that we would be a blessing. And we see it ultimately come to pass in Jesus. Matthew 27:50. And Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and gave up his spirit. And behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And the earth shook. And the rocks were split. You ever imagine, like, if you could time travel and pick a few places where you'd like to go back into history? I want to go there. I want to see him on that cross. And if we could go down into the grave with him just to see what he suffered and went through there, but then see that resurrection, I mean, what would you want to see? You know, think about that. And we learn so much about dealing with the aspects of our heart, personally identifying with the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. You know, you see things like this and put yourself there. See yourself watching this thing happen. You know, imagine what would a... So we know that the veil was probably 3 or 4 inches thick, and it was... How high was it? I think 60 feet high. Imagine what that would have sounded like ripping. Just loud, you know. And the earth shook. Why? So God could get out the box. God could get out of being separated from his people so that he could eventually move inside of us. And we see this in Hebrews 9:11. Christ came as a high priest of the good things to come with the greater and more perfect tabernacle, not with hands, that is, not of this creation. Not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood he entered the most holy place once for all, having obtained eternal redemption. For if the blood of bulls and goats or the ashes of the heifer sprinkling unclean sanctifies the purifying of the flesh, how much more, say how much more, shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? Now see, this is what we get to do. We get to help people cleanse their conscience.
Yeah.
You know, because when you get the opportunity to stand in front of people and share the love of God with them, they start confessing, don't they?
Yep.
If they're ready, they start telling you about, well, you know, I don't really go to church all that. I don't really read my Bible. I did this back in my past. You know, they want to start cleansing their conscience. And I would say engage that process. Engage the process of helping them. I personally identify with what the blood has done for them, and they may just not know. Even if they're Christians, especially if they're Christians. There's a bunch of Christians out there that don't know what the blood's all about. They don't understand the finished work, right? I praise God that you do, but I praise God that you don't just sit on it. I pray that you are mobilized to be a blessing. Say, I am a blessing to the nations, one life at a time. One life at a time. Amen? Honestly, one life at a time. Because you can do that, right? You can do that. So this changed how we interact with the Spirit of God. Hebrews 10:19. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, open for us through that curtain that is his body. And then, let's see. Kind of circle back to 1 Corinthians 16:9. Don't you know, say, don't you know, that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God, that you are not your own. The presence always dwelled among the people for a purpose, to increase their nation, to take land, to be a blessing to all the families and nations of the earth. That is still God's plan for his holy nation. Say, I am God's holy nation. And it's very simple. You know, we are to bring prosperity and help people engage in that treaty of peace that God offers. So, just a reminder, 2 Corinthians 6:16b, for we are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell with them and walk among them. I will be their God and I will be their people. And now we know that he lives in us. Just say, the Spirit of the living God dwells within me. One more time. The Spirit of the living God dwells within me. I'm getting teachy here, but we're going to wrap it up and kind of make some decisions. And then I want to look at Luke 4:18. Somebody said this week. This is what we are to do. This is our message to go into the world with. Luke 4:18. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Let's just read this together, because you can read this of yourself. This is Jesus speaking of himself when he, and you know, people will say, well, Jesus never claimed to be the Messiah. Well, that's about one of the dumbest things you could say. Because just the mere fact that he read this and said, today this is fulfilled in your ears, he may as well have said, I am God in the flesh. I mean, really, because that's what it would have meant to them. That's why they were so upset and tore their clothes and wanted to kill him, because he claimed to be of God, or claimed to be God. Don't, you know, we need to be smarter in the body of Christ, because we'll hear things like that, we get confused, and it's like, no, we need to know the word. Amen? So let's read this together. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set free those who are oppressed, to proclaim the favorable year. Sorry. I'm like, I do speak English, by the way, just because you're wondering. That's your confession. And then our last slide here. I want this to be your conclusion. I carry God's presence to be a blessing. I carry God's presence to be a blessing. Because it's what God has wanted from the very beginning. God just wants to walk among us, be a blessing to us, prosper us, so that we would be a blessing. Is that too simple for you? You know, we went deep this weekend, but again, I want to mobilize you. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to think about this for a minute. I want you to identify three different people in your mind and in your heart right now that you can be a blessing to. And it might be somebody that you know, and it might be where you're going to go to eat. How many of you got a favorite place that you like to eat after church? Yeah. Do you know the server's names by now? You know anybody like that? Or maybe something that you're going to do this week? Maybe it's somebody that you work with. So I want you to think about three different people that you can be a blessing to this week. I'm giving you homework. I'm going to check with Dennis and Denise and see if you did your homework. You got to turn your homework assignment in next week. Y'all okay with that? Pick three people. Now, just think about it. You know, I'm running my mouth here for just a minute to give you time to think about it. I don't need to pause, or do I? You got three people? It's like, wait a minute, am I supposed to actually make it? Yeah. You got four. All right, now, the first one, think about them. The first person that you want to be a blessing to, who is it, and what are you going to do? How can you bless them? You got it? Anybody want to share one? Just as an example? Let somebody be brave. Tell me who and what you're going to do. Who and how you're going to be a blessing to them. Are we online?
Yeah.
Just real quick. Just real quick.
My husband.
Your husband, and you will.
I'll be nice to him.
You'll be nice to him. We'll just leave that one alone right there. Another one? Another one? Yeah. Your neighbor? Just go and see where you can minister. Yeah, just go check on them. Yeah, amen. And you know, that sounds really simple and basic. But honestly, those are the little things that create ministries. Seriously. One more?
My roommate.
Your roommate?
Yeah, buy her coffee.
Buy her coffee. Yeah. Honestly, so simple. So simple. And just put yourself out there. Just put yourself out there to be ready to be a blessing. Because I know what this church is doing. This church is sowing into you week after week after week, bringing people in, sending people out, being a blessing, sowing into you. And you are sitting there full of the Holy Spirit, and He is just itching to get out the box. Do not be the box that's holding the Spirit of God behind the veil, because it's been ripped. Amen? Seriously, don't sit there fat and happy on the mercy seat, holding on to the presence of God, not releasing Him into your life. Because there are people out there that don't know. They don't know. They don't know how good He is. And just the simplest little act of kindness can open the door, and then the next thing you know, my goodness, Lord, I've been praying for this kind of ministry all of my life. It was prophesied to me 20 years ago that I would have this kind of ministry. And all I got to do is take my neighbor coffee? That's what's going to open the door? You mean I just got to, when I'm in the hardware store, actually stop and ask that person if I can pray for them? And then the next thing you know, they're inviting you to speak to their family or whatever, you know what I mean? Honestly, the Holy Spirit, it's like we don't trust the Holy Spirit or something. You know, it's like we don't think that He can actually lead us and guide us step by step just by from taking the first step. Amen? Say, I will take the first step. I will not keep God in a box, which means in you. You're the box. Amen? One more time. I am a blessing to the nations, one life at a time. Father, we thank You so much for the opportunity to carry Your presence. We will let You out of the box. We will let You out of our own hearts and out of our own minds. We will not keep You in there wrestling with You inside of our own minds for our own lives and our own purposes. We're just going to believe that You want everything that You promised for us to manifest. We're just going to go ahead and believe that. And we're going to make the decision to go. Say, I will go. I will move forward. I will take that step. I will be a blessing to the nations of the world and one life at a time. Amen? Now, will you do it? Honestly, please do it. I am pleading with you. Go do it. Amen? All right. Thank you, guys. Love you. Appreciate you. Nice and tight. And Dennis, appreciate you. So glad to be here.
Give it up. Give it up. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.